everyone. I'm Michelle Long. It's 9 in Manila, 10 in Tokyo, and 12 noon in Sydney. The headlines. Asian shares fall at the start of a brand new trading week amid lingering recession and rate hike fears. U.S. stock futures, though, edging higher after a roller coaster week. Here at home, the PSE index kicks off from 59.04 after falling last week. Rustin Mercado of China Bank Securities joins us for his market outlook. We'll also discuss food security here in the Philippines with a focus on meat supply. Anthony Nang of North Star Meat Merchants joins us later on in the show for that. And OPEC and its allies defend their planned output cut of 2 million barrels per day next month amid a word war between the U.S. and Saudi Arabia. Local pump prices, meanwhile, headed for another hike this week. We begin with the financial markets. Asian shares starting the week on the back foot as investors brace for further drastic tightening in global financial conditions amid lingering recession fears. So far, Australia's ASX 200 leading the slide, down 1.6% in early trade. Japan's Nikkei 225 and South Korea's KOSPI index also falling at the open. Over in the Middle East, most stock markets ended lower on Sunday following last week's drop in oil prices. Saudi Arabia's benchmark TASI index slipping a 0.1%, hit by a 1% slide in oil giant Saudi Aramco. Shares in Qatar also extending losses while markets in Israel were closed for a holiday. Now, over on Wall Street, stock futures edging higher as investors await more big earnings reports to roll in. So far, all the major indices still pointing to a higher open decisively when trading resumes tonight, Manila time. Now, remember, on Friday, stocks capped off a volatile week of trading with losses as investors continued to worry about hot inflation and rising interest rates. Still, as you can see, the Dow managing to post modest gains last week, while the S&P and the Nasdaq fell for the week. Wall Street also kicking off the third quarter earnings season. And here's a quick recap of the reports from big banks. JP Morgan beat estimates as the biggest U.S. bank by assets took advantage of rising rates to generate more interest income. JP Morgan's revenue jumping 10% in the third quarter to $33.5 billion. Morgan Stanley, meanwhile, missed expectations driven by the falloff in investment banking and declines in investment management revenue. As for Wells Fargo, it topped estimates for the third quarter, but still posted a fall in profit, hurt by operating losses of $2 billion related to litigation, customer remediation, and regulatory matters. It's going to be a busy week this week with reports from Bank of America, Goldman Sachs, Netflix, and Tesla all on deck in the coming days. Some foreign business headlines now. OPEC and its allies on the defensive after their planned massive output cut of 2 million barrels per day next month was announced. See, the U.S. suggested last week the production cut was, quote, engineered by Saudi Arabia for political reasons, as it would boost Russia's foreign earnings. That claim has been denied by the kingdom. Its defense minister, Prince Khalid bin Salman, asserts the decision was unanimous and was based on economic reasons. His comment was echoed by Iraq, which added the move supports market stability in a period of uncertainty. Other members issued similar statements, while the group's secretary general said the output cut was a preemptive measure and that OPEC's decisions are always technical. Here at home, local pump prices set to go up for a second straight week. Diesel and kerosene prices may jump by up to 3 pesos per liter, while gasoline prices may rise by up to 1 peso and 10 centavos per liter. Industry players still citing OPEC's planned production cut as the main reason for this week's price increase. Now, over in China, President Xi Jinping says his government will be enacting proactive policies to boost the country's birth rate. He made that announcement in his speech marking the start of the Communist Party Congress in Beijing over the weekend. Although China has 1.4 billion people, the most in the world, its births are set to fall to record lows this year. Policymakers are now worried an imminent decline in China's population could hurt the world's second biggest economy. Meanwhile, Vogue Singapore gets penalized for supposedly promoting non-traditional families. The Singaporean government says it has shortened the publishing permit of Vogue Singapore due to a breach of content guidelines on four occasions within the past 2 years. It is accused of glamorizing alternative lifestyles and for featuring nudity. Singapore has very strict policies restricting LGBTQ content within the city, state's publications. Now, our first guest this morning is part of the country's food security narrative. From a college thesis to one of the biggest suppliers of meat, partnered with one of the country's biggest retail plays, North Star Meat Merchants is raring to grow capacity to serve growing demand. It had to defer its 4 billion peso IPO, though, due to market conditions. So how does the next 6 to 12 months look like for the company? Let's ask its founder and CEO, Anthony Nam. Tony, hi. Welcome to Market Edge.
Hi. Good morning, Mimi. Thank you for having us back again.
All right. So, Tony, why don't you give us a sense of how you're doing today? With so many challenges in the macro environment, from a stronger dollar, which makes importation more expensive, to inflation.
So, Mimi, very simply, all hands on deck tayo ngayon. Mm-hmm. Being that we know that food prices are going up, inflation, dollar affecting everything. Our focus now is really to be ultra efficient in doing each and every aspects of our operation. Mm-hmm. As I mentioned earlier, and to everyone, being efficient, no, gives us that edge, no, gives us the capacity to give our prices, no, our products at a very competitive price on market. And this is very, very relevant, especially when each and every household right now is trying to save, no, and make sense of their household budgets. Mm-hmm.
So what do you mean by efficient, ultra efficient to be exact? What does that mean?
So our business is compromised of different operations, no, from logistics, warehousing, cutting, fabrication, even transporting the meat, no, up to the retailing itself.
Yes.
Sa mga supermarkets.
Yes.
Right, supermarket. So one of which we undertook solarizing all of our biggest plant, the one in Biginto. Mm-hmm. So that gives us a bit of savings energy, very timely. And when we actually decided to employ solar, no, sa Biginto, we didn't even have the Ukraine-Russia war pa. Mm-hmm. But forward thinking tayo, and part of our ESG, we did so. So now we're reaping the benefits, no, the savings of that. Doing our own logistics, our fleet of refrigerated trucks also saves us 1-2 pesos per kilo. No? Same with managing our own distribution hubs, our cold storages, saves us another few pesos per kilo. And again, when we save, no, this peso per kilo doon sa aming mga products, all of these are translated and they're passed on to our consumers. Mm-hmm. So that's how we basically do the business.
Yeah. Tony, I'm very curious. We're now a month of October. How many times have you had to raise prices of your pork products, for example? And are you expecting to raise some more in time for Noche Buena, or no more price hikes from your end?
Well, we have actually not raised our prices for the past quarter. Mm. No, I think for almost, yeah, more than that. Sabi ko nga, the way we do things are different. We use technology. We do forecasting, no? We store already 2 months ahead what we're supposed to use for the consumption of the store. So doing these things, no, gives us a better how do you control, no, in terms of our pricing, no? Mm-hmm. And our really focus is are the consumers. Consumer centric tayo. So basically, we do all that we can from our side to make sure that our consumers are benefiting from our economies of scale, from our cost savings, from our efficiency. So no increase for the past how many months. Moving forward, that we don't know. You have a higher dollar, you have a higher production cost abroad. No, our supplies comes from North America. Brazil, no, and then a little bit from Australia and whatnot, and then you still have that African swine fever still, no, persisting. So moving forward, we don't know. We'll see, no. We'll play it by ear na lang muna.
I'm very curious though, Tony, how are you hedging? I know that you do 2 months of inventory in advance, but also your contracts are on an annual basis. I know big companies are trying to lock in volumes at current prices, at current exchange rates. Are you able to negotiate the same with your suppliers, considering we're all expecting the dollar to stay strong until next year, inflation to stay elevated until next year?
Yes, we've been doing that with both of the local and the international suppliers. Yes. We've enjoyed that 2 decades worth of relationship with them. So maganda na yung ano, yung tulungan natin on that aspect. And then for local farms naman that we are working with, I think they have the economies of scale to be able to sufficiently address our supply and you know, cushion yung mga certain price because also of their size they can.
Is it 50-50, Tony? 50% local, 50% imported products?
Oh,
for
no.
You?
No. That ratio really will vary depending on first, no, the availability of the supply, and then the affordability of the supply.
Okay.
Right? And third, and more importantly, the situation of the animal disease, no? Because we have to look at the countries where we can import from. We have to look at the regions naman locally where we can procure our stocks from.
All right.
So those are the three at least major considerations for us.
And currently, what's the ratio today?
Right now, there is a big bump in terms of local, no? Because you have an African swine fever situation. A lot of these farms are being proactive, no? Bago siguro, there's that kind of a bit of fear, maybe, na parang baka tamaan kami, we want to already process, no? Or parang get our herd, our stock out na. So a lot of them has been coming to us to help them digest the production. So, yeah, so
mostly local ngayon.
Yeah, mostly local ngayon. Maraming local ngayon actually. All right.
Because the Meat Importers Association of the Philippines was on the show, I think 2-3 weeks ago, and he was saying that the Philippines is now competing for pork products. He said that there is a 1-3% reduction in sow numbers happening in major pork producing regions of the world. That's Europe and North America. So Asian countries, we're all competing for a dwindling sort of supply in pork products. Do you feel, is this what you're feeling on the ground as well when you try to import?
I am not so sure of how the right Mita people see that situation. But here's the thing, no? Nasa news lang kanina umaga already, we know that we've imported 1 billion worth kilos of meat. Right? So I think we have more than enough or our supplies are sufficient up to the end of the year. So as for the competing part, we've been always competing naman with all of our neighbors, eh. Especially Japan, no, Hong Kong, Singapore, diba? Hindi naman sila agricultural country to begin with. Not as much na in terms of pork especially. So that situation has always been present.
I see.
It's nothing new.
Uh-oh. Nothing new. All right. Let's talk about the demand side now. I know that you're taking your partnership with a major client, SM, to another level. You're turning their Alphamart convenience stores into mini meat shops. Talk to us about that.
Mimi, grabbing radar mo. I don't know how you naunahan mo pa lahat.
So what's the plan?
Yeah. So what's going to happen there is, you know, you have 1,000 branches of Alphamart, community level siya, based na stores. So it's doing an evolution in terms of how we dispense fresh and frozen products. You do it in a cleaner, you know, environment, air conditioned yan, compliant, safe and affordable manner. So that's taking the meat shop to the community level, ganun siya. And we're very happy because very inclusive siya, eh, that will generate a lot of jobs. No? For one, sa store level, if you have 1,000 stores, automatically you're looking at 1,000, 2,000 people will have jobs. And then sa back end, which a lot of people don't see, the people who process that, who do the pick, the packing, the fabricating of the meat, another, you know, percentage of jobs being created. And then because of being able to do business in that manner, we are able to inspire yung entrepreneurship, micro entrepreneurship, kasi maraming bumibili sa atin dyan, or the eateries, no? And then of course we can also affect household savings, which is the most important thing, no? These days, no? The most relevant issue, no? Yung pagtitipid nga.
So you're going to roll out in 12 stores first and then see where that goes?
We are already in 12 stores. We're gathering data muna. We're looking at what kind of setup is effective, depending on the size and the location of the store. Once we have all of these things with us, no, and accurately, we can do a rollout na for the 1,000.
Won't this cannibalize on the other brands that you supply meat to?
Definitely not, because this is your neighborhood shop.
Neighborhood shop. All right.
We're not here to cannibalize our competition, our own stores, even the wet markets. None of that. This is more of parang, it's like saying that if you go to a convenience shop, you're not really going against the supermarket or the wet market, right? It's more of a action of convenience ba?
All right. So the demand outlook, when Filipinas start tightening their belts because of inflation, the macroeconomic picture is gloomy. Do you think that meat is among the first to go in their diet? I mean, how elastic is demand for meat?
You see, first, it's pegged sa population natin. Right? Philippines demographic is young. A young median age means people want flavor in their food. So that's a good, healthy combination of meat and fats, no? So that's where we are, no? Beef and pork and poultry. Right? A younger population, what's that? A flavor sa food. Next, we can also use as an example yung nangyari sa COVID during the lockdowns, diba? So it's a different, let's call it na lang a crisis, no? A health crisis. This might be and we hope not, a financial crisis. So when these situations occur, crisis, ang unang pupuntahan ng tao is really food, to secure food, no, more than anything else. So we're not the first to go. We're the first ones to be bought, actually.
During
crisis. We're the most necessary. I think restaurants and tourism ang tatamaan dyan, because when you tighten your belt, you're not gonna bring your money out of it. Yeah, you're not gonna bring out your money dun sa right, by traveling or going to a restaurant where you have to pay a little bit of a premium, no, for your meal. What you do is you buy a kilo of meat, you portion that, you cook at home. So that's what you do.
So healthy volume pa rin ang outlook. What about the health side? Going beyond meat and healthy, do you think that trend is going to catch up? How will the meat industry of the future look like? And what is your role in that future? Are you also going into the healthy meat alternatives, or you're going to stick to the traditional meat?
You know, healthy meat and meat, maraming contention dyan, which is more healthier than the other. But both of them naman, really, we can cater to, and we will cater to. Part of the business kasi of Northstar is the cold logistics area, no? So the healthy meat, no, variant requires refrigeration and distribution. So they will still have to go to us and right, for distribution and proper storage of the products. So okay lang, whatever way the consumer tends to go, we'll stand to benefit from that.
Interesting.
We'll take a neutral stand. We'll take a neutral stand na lang there, kasi maraming ano dyan, maraming talagang, like, ako personally, ha, like, ano lang, kabiat. Meat is meat, you know. A good steak is a good steak at the end of the day for me.
That makes sense. Just very quickly, annual output or volumes would be 38.5 million kilograms. That's a lot of meat that you are producing, that you're moving around every year. How are your volumes this year? Are you up?
Let's use na lang figures more than kilos. No? So
right.
Pre-IPO, we promised supposedly the public a guidance of 9.5 billion this year. So I think we're on target naman. We're going to hit that.
You're going to hit that. All right. You deferred your IPO. When is it finally going to happen? Will this also mean deferred expansion plans as well?
No. For the IPO, really, everyone is on a wait and see.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, we will not get into something na we're gonna bring along our investors into a, you know, into a bad spot. No, we don't want to be perpetually known as someone na parang, diba, you go into IPO, biglang unsuccessful siya. Yeah. Took us 24, well, at least took me 24 years from my thesis till now. I want to do it right lang. So, mm-hmm. It's a very momentous undertaking.
Oh.
So, we'll wait and see. Maybe end of 23 or 24, hopefully. We'll see how it goes. No?
All right. And on that optimistic note, knowing that you're going to be hitting your targets this year, thank you very much, Tony, for joining us. And we hope to speak to you when the IPO is finally back on track.
Yes, please. Thank you very much always for having us in mind also.
All right. Have a great week ahead.
Have a great week ahead. Take care, Mimi. And good morning to all of our viewers.
All right. Thank you. Now, moving on to more news. U.S. President Joe Biden brushing off risks of the strong dollar on the global economy. He says the currency is not the one dragging the global economy, as he blamed slow growth on policy missteps in other parts of the world. The U.S. Federal Reserve has moved ahead with a series of dramatic rate hikes to tackle decades-high inflation, making the dollar more attractive to investors. But while a strong dollar helps to hold down U.S. inflation as it lowers the prices of imported goods, it can negatively affect poor countries by increasing their import costs and the burden of their dollar-denominated debts. The Philippine peso is among the currencies hit by a strong dollar, reaching an all-time low of 59 against the greenback. Now, here are some economic data releases we're monitoring today, Monday. Indonesia and China will come out with their respective trade balance figures for the month of September. And from Italy, we get final September inflation print. Initial estimates show consumer prices there likely rose to 8.9% in September, the highest in nearly 37 years, due to the acceleration in the cost of food. Now, here's a look at the other stories we're tracking today. Several groups mark World Food Day with a protest outside the Philippine Agriculture Department. Meanwhile, the Senate Committee on Basic Education will check the progress of the implementation of K-12 program. And at 5 this afternoon, President Bongbong Marcos will attend the Philippine Tourism Industry Reception at the SMX Convention Center in Pasay City. Up next, let's set you up for the new trading week with Rusty Mercado of China Bank Securities. Market Edge will be right back. Watching Market Edge, the headlines: Asian shares falling flat at the start of a new trading week amid lingering recession and rate hike fears. U.S. stock futures edging higher after a roller coaster week. Here at home, the PSE index kicks off from 59.04 after falling last week. Rusty Mercado of China Bank Securities joins us for a market outlook. North Star Meat Merchant CEO Anthony Yang says, well, the company is consumer-centric and has avoided price hikes despite elevated inflation. It cannot say for sure how prices will fare in the coming months as a stronger dollar and translates to higher production costs. North Star sources its products mostly from North America and Australia, but says right now, locally sourced porks have a bigger share in the mix. And OPEC and its allies defend their plant output cut of 2 million barrels per day next month amid a word war between the U.S. and Saudi Arabia. Local pump prices, meanwhile, head for another hike this week. So we are kicking off from 59.04, up last Friday, but down for the week. Year to date, the PSE index's return is still at -17%. Everybody's looking bearish, but is it time to sell? Or is it time to be a stock picker? To help us take stock, Rustine Mercado of China Bank Securities joins us this morning. Rustine, welcome back to Market Edge. Hi.
Hi, Mimi. Good morning.
Good morning. So have you had to cut your PSC target for end of year? And what to you is the most interesting piece of the puzzle today?
Well, we haven't taken a look at it again yet, especially mm-hmm. since we'd want to wait for the upcoming earnings season first, mm-hmm. so we can see how companies fared. And of course, we want to listen to what their outlook is for next year. I think the key takeaways here are three things, right? So first, this year has been a very unpredictable year. We can see this in how much adjustments in targets and estimates have been made so far. We've seen that in inflation, we've seen that in GDP, we've seen that in terminal policy rates, index targets. And then, of course, with respect to index targets, of course, they best work when the market is acting rationally. And based on what we've been seeing, sentiment has been the key driver of market action over the past several months, right? And the other thing here is, of course, tighter liquidity is adding more fuel to the flame. And I think the best testament to this is how dry turnover has been over the past couple of weeks. We've seen turnover just a little bit below 3 billion pesos in some days, right? So there's really very little buying appetite based on what we're seeing. And of course, that's expected given the uncertainty in the market right now.
Mm-hmm. That's true. I mean, also going back to the earnings, when you've got the Fed and the BSP, you know, not stopping anytime soon, they're tightening. How do you imagine risk assets like equities will hold up or even rally in an environment like this?
Well, I think exactly right. That's the hard thing. This year, we've seen both bonds and equities move lower, and I think that's a function of really liquidity being sapped away from the market. So it's taking a while for your market to kind of absorb all those assets, right? So I think it's really hard. Right now, what we've been seeing is the markets have been particularly reactive to what could prompt the Fed to hike even further. Or maybe slow their pace of hiking, right? So we've seen that in the past couple of weeks in terms of implied federal funds rate targets or terminal rate in March, mm-hmm. That has moved from around 4.25, 4.5 all the way to 4.5, 4.75 between that 50 bip juncture, right? So okay. That's really how volatile markets have been.
So here's the thing: when you look at bear markets of the past, how much rally from lows are you expecting? Do you typically see, and over what period of time? Because everybody's trying to time this market. Well, it's not smart to be catching a falling knife. We want to have an idea based on history. What does history tell us?
Well, first of all, we are in bear market territory, mm-hmm. but I think the formal bear market is also characterized by having been 2 months below the bear market threshold, which is for us around 6,000, right? So mm-hmm. it might take another month for us to formally be in that. How long a bear market lasts really varies because they have different underlying drivers. So each bear market is different. For this one, apart from inflation, you're also looking at the market shift in monetary policy, and that's sapping liquidity away from the market at a very swift pace. Mm-hmm. So for the PSEI, the 2020 bear market lasted a little over half a year, while the 2008 bear market lasted over 1.5 years. So if one were to look at the bear market of 2008, the index shed 48.3% in 2008, but in the succeeding year, it did stage a 63% rally, right? So again, it's hard to gauge what the market will do, but hopefully once the hiking stops, then mm-hmm. we might see really clouds parting and, you know, a forward direction kind of moving in sight. Mm-hmm.
But until then, how are you guiding your estimates for earnings? I mean, when you've got growth sales, the top line beating earnings growth, the bottom line, will companies have a harder time attributing what growth is going to look like in a persistently high inflation where margins are getting eaten up? Are you guiding earnings estimates lower at this point?
Well, right now, we did revise in September, after the earnings season of the mm-hmm. second quarter. And some of those have moved higher, some lower. But in terms of lower in general, those revisions will likely happen, given that, of course, you have the dragon growth starting to materialize, especially coming to next year. Right now, conversations with some companies still point to continuing strength in the third quarter. And I think that's not surprising given how the reopening story has been quite strong for us this year. Mm-hmm. It's also worthy to note that target prices have already come down, given, of course, higher costs of equity and debt. Of course, what's more concerning for us now is really the downward re-rating and valuations. Right now, at around 5.9, we're trading at 14 times 2022 earnings. That's a far cry from the five-year average of 18 times, right? The good thing with 14 times is that it already coincides with your 2006-2009 average. So we're in terms of where rational is given possible sentiment being priced in, 14 times is a good space to be in. But of course, right now, it's really sentiment that has a lot more to do with price action rather than fundamentals at this point.
Mm-hmm. All right. And speaking of sentiment and pricing, it looks like it's a negative sentiment this morning. The PSEI opening lower, right now trading down by a fifth of 1%, 10 points, 58.95. You know, Racine, there's no major local data in the pipeline for this week, although we are on China watch as the economic powerhouse holds its 20th National Congress of the Communist Party, which kicked off over the weekend. Are there locally listed companies that you're monitoring in relation to this? Companies that have the most exposure to developments in China?
Well, I think generally, companies do have exposure to China, right? Mm-hmm. What we're looking at particularly, we have the exporters of our semicon, for example, Cirtec, Mikkel.
Christine?
Mining companies, mm-hmm. for exposures in China. But of course, some companies are also building out solar farms, right? That they have a large exposure to China because they're a sizable supplier in the solar PV market, right? So with respect to the China story, however, easing lockdowns should help quell some bottlenecks seen there throughout this year. Mm-hmm. And hopefully that should shore up domestic consumer demand for goods and services on their end. So that could help suppliers from here export it to there. Mm-hmm. Of course, on the flip side, higher demand from China also means possibly higher commodity prices, such as oil, right? So again, it's really more of a balancing act. But of course, more investors are concerned about the growth slowdown there. So if that moves higher, then sentiment might flow back into Asia.
Never black and white, so many gray areas, so many moving parts. The challenge really is for investors to drown out the noise and know where to focus their attention on. In the meantime, Racine, let's go over some interesting corporate stories that we have. State-owned Pinoc Exploration Corporation is allocating an indicative budget of 10.7 billion pesos for 2023. This as the government, you know, tries to move forward with, you know, finding our own source of fuel and insulating the Philippines from external shocks and prices. A quick opinion on this.
Well, it's good, of course. We need to get additional natural gas from domestic sources. That has been some concern. For example, the Ilihan plant needs nat gas as feedstock, right? So if we were to get more supply domestically, then it could reinforce domestic energy security.
All right. So, of course, Pinoc has 7 petroleum service contracts plus 4 coal operating contracts, and it also trades coal through its coal terminal in Zamboanga, Sibugay. From power and fuel, let's go to telecom. Globe Telecom saying that iPhone is still in demand despite inflation. In fact, they're saying the iPhone 14 launch that happened last week even beat, you know, volumes from the previous events from iPhone 13. What does this say about, you know, demand staying strong despite inflationary pressure? This is a good sign, or is it not?
Well, that's actually a thing, right? Domestically, the consumer appears to be strong, at least for your modern trade channels. So I think that's one to be a little bit optimistic about. But of course, you have pent-up savings from the pandemic kind of being deployed this year, right? So how that will pan out next year, that's actually the question that we're trying to find out the answer to.
All right, we'll just have to wait and see then. Also, the Gokongwei Group has officially rebranded Ministop to Uncle John's Design. I'm not sure if we have a photo or a video of that, but the colors are different. I'm not sure if you've seen the color. It's, there you go. From Ministop, this is how the Uncle John's now look. Netizens not too hot about it, but what do you think? It's still a retail play though, right? Are you confident?
Yeah, and I think the good thing with that is that you have return to office, return to school, right? And convenience stores typically enjoy windfall from those. So could be greater greater months ahead for RHI with respect to that business.
But when you look at what the SM Group is doing to Alpha Mart, which is also a convenience store, they're going to be converting those into mini meat shops. Makes you think, what's the SM Group seeing in that space or not seeing? That's why they're converting. But that let's just wait and see on that. How about this? Power. Norwegian-based renewable energy company Scatec ASA is going to develop over 2 gigawatts of wind power projects here in the Philippines with the Aboitiz Group. So far, they have 5 sites already. One is onshore. The rest are offshore. Of course, last week, the Aboitiz Group, Aboitiz Renewable Inc., actually announced its entry or its first foray into wind. What do you think? What does this make the Aboitiz Power name as a stock even more attractive to investors?
Well, I think so. Our renewable energy remains a strong secular story. Mm-hmm. And of course, there are concerns now because of higher build costs, given, of course, one is cost of debt, the other is strong dollar. But RE remains the way to move forward. And I think the good thing with wind is that it's not too much explored. I mean, like, it's not as heavily deployed, or at least plans to deploy, as solar here. So that's a good thing to have those other sources of renewable energy in the pipeline.
All right. And speaking of renewable, first-gen LNG, at least in the transition, they're saying that the development of LNG terminal is on track to be completed by the first quarter of 2023. And Macro Asia of the Lusitan Group, which is into, you know, servicing for aviation airlines, they're preparing to venture into fixed-line internet in 3 to 5 years. Is this a good call?
Well, I think over the long term, fixed broadband internet still is a strong story. I think right now the concern is that it's becoming kind of a crowded space, given that the shift is going back to mobile data demand instead, right? So, of course, value accretion down the long term with your population growing and, of course, increased demand for digital services should help buoy that demand over the long term.
All right. And of course, just wanted to share, the Philippine Central Bank has also approved $178 million in third quarter borrowings for the country's nutrition program. And speaking of the dollar, the peso actually opened slightly weaker this morning, 58.97 against last Friday's close of 58.935. But at least we're trying to stay away from 59, trying at least. Your take on the dollar, Restine?
Well, I think, of course, you do have that pressure from, of course, the Fed. It's really what the Fed will be doing, right? If they move their terminal rates higher, and, of course, you kind of match the pace, then, of course, that pressure would be relieved. But, of course, it really depends on the market, right? So hopefully, at this point, they're starting to be comfortable with where things are at in terms of the differential. And hopefully, we don't see a further or steep depreciation already.
All right. And finally, the World Bank says the Philippine poverty level could ease to 17.1% in 2022. Restine, we've come to the most exciting part of the conversation. Your blind item. Talk to us about the stock that you're monitoring closely. Don't tell us. Just describe. What do you have for us today?
Okay. So this is a retail company that has formats that cater to consumers across the spectrum. Right? So for the first half, its performance showed continued growth in top line. And year-on-year margin expansion due to continued cost control measures and stronger supplier support. Recent market developments, however, have led its stock price to sink to near 2020 lows, which may lead to a technical rally in the near term. Current forward PE is around 8 times. That's much lower than the average of around 5-year average of around 17 times. If prices are able to rally back to the 200-day exponential moving average resistance, of course, more technicals here, then the technical upside should be north of 15%.
Ah, 15% sounds good. We're just going to have to guess which stock this is. Restine, always a pleasure to speak with you. Have a great week ahead. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you for having me, and have a great week ahead.
All right. Now, more details on Chinese President Xi Jinping's speech during the Communist Party Congress. He says China will never commit to abandoning the use of force when it comes to the Taiwan issue. She adds the reunification of the motherland must and will be achieved. China sees Taiwan as part of its territory to be reclaimed one day by military intervention if necessary.
Resolving the Taiwan issue is a matter for Chinese people themselves and must be resolved by Chinese people alone. we will adhere to striving for the prospect of a peaceful reunification with the greatest sincerity and greatest efforts, but will never commit to abandoning the use of force.
She also promoted and defended a range of his signature policies, including zero COVID. The Chinese president signaled there would be no immediate loosening of the strategy, which has saved lives but also exacted a punishing toll on the Chinese population and economy.
Especially when facing the unexpected COVID-19 pandemic, we adhere to putting the people and their lives first. Adhere to an unwavering, dynamic zero COVID policy, waging a people's war, a total war, and a blockade war to fight the pandemic, protecting people's safety and health to the highest degree. We achieved significant positive results in coordinating epidemic prevention and control with social and economic development.
Time now to zip through the top headlines from major business papers. From Business World, the tourism department says Siargao and Surigao del Norte is considered a priority area for tourism development. It notes government is aiming to help Siargao recover with infrastructure projects and granting the island gateway status for direct flights. From Business Mirror, the Department of Agrarian Reforms renews talks with Aboitiz-led Pilmico Foods Corporation to promote sustainable livelihood for members of Agrarian Reform Beneficiaries Organizations, or ARBO. And from the Wall Street Journal, oil giant ExxonMobil hires former investment banker and former General Motors executive Dan Amman to build a climate-friendly business unit. Is kicking off the ASEAN FinTech Festival this week. On the agenda, the cooperation of enterprises at the national and regional levels with the goal of making digital work for everybody. And joining us this morning, FinTech Association of the Philippines Executive Director Amor Maklang and Coins.ph CEO Wei Cho. Amor, Wei, thank you so much for joining us this morning. Hi.
Thank you so much, Mimi, for having us.
Good morning. Thanks for having me.
All right. So, Amor, I want to start with you. The festival will be making the rounds in Asia. What is the key message?
All right. So, Mimi, from the time the FinTech festivals have started a few years back, it is no accident that for the first time, all the various FinTech groups and digital economy groups are lining up. So we opened in the Philippines from October 17 to 21. We moved to Thailand, then to Singapore, then to Cambodia, and then we end in Indonesia. So it is no accident that it's all lining up every year moving forward. We want to make a statement to the world that the place to be from October to November every year to build your digital economy is in ASEAN.
You know, Amor, this FinTech festival is happening against a backdrop of, you know, a gloomy macro picture, a sharp correction in tech companies. You've got giants, startup giants like Grab and Shopee sounding more alarm bells over profitability. Why now? What is the mood right now in fintech in general?
Okay, so listen, this is beyond fintech, and that's exactly why I'm proud to have my co-convener here, Wei, who'll talk about things beyond just fintech. But let me address that. So I know you might be referring to the crypto winter, supposedly, and the investment winter that's happening globally. But I assure you, there is no winter in Southeast Asia, or at least you barely feel it here. But really, this is not the first time a contraction in the economy has happened, and it certainly won't be the last. And our theme this year is all about building anti-fragile digital economies. And the only way we can be not just resilient, but anti-fragile is by adopting digital. Mm-hmm. And the Philippines is actually taking on a very important role, not just in the Philippines, but also to the rest of the world. It's a great soft landing haven for various regions. ASEAN, we have guests coming from Central Europe, Central Asia, even from the Levant region, and also even in areas that are experiencing some political headwinds. They're all coming together to join us build the digital economy.
All right, interesting. Wei, I want to go to you. Amor just mentioned anti-fragile. What exactly, how would you define anti-fragile in your context? I mean, as Coins.ph, what is your role in this, in digitalizing, you know, in bringing, in creating a digital Pilipinas?
Yeah, I think one of the biggest challenges I think see for the Philippines over the last, I think, you know, 5 to 10 years is actually building up financial inclusion. Mm-hmm. And I think what's really, really amazing, like, I think most of the players in our industry have done an amazing job in terms of bringing more, you know, Filipinos, not just online, but actually becoming more financially inclusive which has been enabled, I think, by the fintech movement. I think what's going to drive the next wave of growth in the fintech movement is actually going to be digital assets and Web3, mm-hmm. as we move from financial inclusion to financial empowerment. And I think that's what we hope to do here at Coins is actually, you know, make Web3, make digital assets, not just accessible, but actually easy to use, safe. And then also creating wealth for yourself through the ownership of digital assets.
Mm-hmm. But realistically, though, Wei, when do you expect that we're going to have economies of scale? When is that inflection point when majority of Filipinos, when, you know, this becomes a reality for majority of Filipinos?
Yeah, I think one thing I kind of point to is like last year when I think, you know, the country as a whole, and I think a lot of, you know, non-coiners or non-digital assets owners actually got, you know, own some NFTs or own some gaming assets for the first time. Mm-hmm. And they actually discovered that they can actually own digital assets and then actually generate wealth. Yes, the sort of the wealth creation effect has come down significantly due to sort of, you know, the price drop in digital assets over the last 6 months. But I do think, you know, that proof of concept is going to get proliferated over the next, you know, I think immediately in the next 12 months as more and more just, you know, people become not just become aware of the ownership and the ability, but I think as more creators come in and actually create in this space based on the assets.
All right. Amor, I want to go to you. You know, getting to a digital Pilipinas will require a massive public-private partnership. You're going to need government on board, you know. You've got the national ID rollout taking forever. The SIM card registration law just signed is proving to be a little bit more complicated than thought. What is your advice to government? What do you need for government to do to make this happen?
I'm not here to advise anyone, but I'll tell you something. Digital Pilipinas is a whole of nation and a whole of society approach. I mean, the word fintech might be a little bit misleading only because you think it's about payments. No, it's not, right? So we have the DICT, the DOST, the DOF, the DTI, all working and advising and supporting us. And it's not just the Philippine government. We also are working very closely with the governments of Hungary, Israel, Indonesia, and Singapore, right? So we are getting the benefit of the best practices from all over the world and bringing it down to a digital Pilipinas. The heart of digital Pilipinas is really in the afternoon sessions. So you've heard of software as a service. We have advocacy as a service. 12 industries sitting down together with national line agencies, with regulators, non-teched up incumbents, and the technologists. Mm-hmm. We're going to work on a roadmap in an hour, and in 30 minutes, listen to the pitches. Uh-huh. together with our partners, we are now going to oversee and work closely with them throughout the year and see how we can bring one or two changes in various industries. Ah. So we're excited.
All right, we're just gonna have to wait and see which industries will benefit. Wei, I'm curious, you know, for the longest time, FinTech has been seen as a space for the smaller, nimbler, digital-first startups, disrupting, you know, the bigger, brawnier corporations. But when you've got giants, you know, starting to get into, you know, the space, you know, how does this change the landscape? You know, how does this change the game? Are you expecting a lot more consolidation at this point?
I think we'll see both. I think we'll see small companies innovate. One thing that's really unique about Coins, I think, you know, we're small. You know, we're one of the earlier companies in the digital asset industry. You know, we're basically one of the first place where a lot of Filipinos bought their first Bitcoin. And that was a good purchase for them, right? And I think most of our users will remember that. And I think when you create wealth for your users, I think they will remember you. And I think that's where sort of like for the small players like us, we think that by innovating and then adding more interesting products, interesting services, and making it, you know, fun in the process, I think the users will come. And I think we've seen that over the last, you know, 20 years in traditional internet. And I think we're going to see that, I think, in the blockchain, the digital asset industry as well. In terms of coming back to your comment about how government can help, I actually think government can do a lot here in terms of, you know, supporting growth of the local players. And I think this is really, really important because I think what we've seen in the internet is actually sort of, you know, countries themselves lost sovereignty over information. I think information is sort of, you know, what was sort of dispersed over the last, you know, and I think the next wave of growth is actually going to be the digitalization of money. And I think it's really critical for governments to support, you know, local companies, local industries, as that's sort of the only way for them to sort of, you know, protect at least, you know, sovereignty over their money. And I think that's really, really important for us, you know, come into the FinTech Festival to discuss, you know, for not just ourselves, but I think for, you know, for the incumbents in the traditional, you know, financial industry as well.
All right. And final question to both Amor and Wei. And I want to go full circle. You know, I want to go to where it all began and where you think it's headed. What is your digital story? Where did your digital story begin very quickly? And where do you see it going 10 years from now when we have a conversation like this? What are we even going to be talking about? Let's start with Amor, ladies first. Maybe Wei and then Amor.
So Wei's story is more interesting than mine.
Yeah, I'll jump in. I mean, I've been in tech. I think, you know, I'm a little bit older here. I sort of like had a dorm room startup like back in the summer of like 2000, like in 99, 2000 during the dot-com boom. I did my undergrad at Harvard. So I like, you know, probably jumped the gun a little bit. You know, Zuckerberg was much more successful with his dorm room startup. But I think, you know, over the last 20 plus years, I've seen sort of, you know, digital technology transform how we live. You know, I still had a brick cell phone, you know, when I first started working, right? But now it's like, you know, I have a mini technology world in my phone. I think the next big wave, I think, you know, in about 10 years, we're going to have this conversation in the metaverse. The interviews may or may not be me, but it may be in an avatar version of me talking to an avatar version of you. But I think we're going to have a lot more people watching and we're going to have a lot more people connected. And because we're going to all participate and own and we're going to be able to own and participate and earn, I think, from the sort of, you know, eventual world that we're going to build with digital assets, I think, in the metaverse.
A new world on the metaverse, Amor?
So my history, 5 years ago, I led the Philippine delegation in the Singapore FinTech Festival, and I said, putting the Philippines in the map is going to be my lifelong dream. I thank people like Wei who gave me a very unique perspective about the role of the Philippines in the metaverse. For example, I can't believe Wei, you didn't tell them this. So I'm going to channel Wei about the Philippines being at the front and center, consumer of coins and creators. Where are we going to be in a few years' time? Absolutely cross-border. In other words, our track right now in Digital Filipinas is all about bringing companies and startups. We have 4 unicorns in our consortium. We have even more startups coming from the provinces. And our objective is to soft land them in ASEAN, bring them to markets like the EU, where they can do their own proof of concept, where we're all working together. The new Silk Road is technology, and the Philippines is going to be part of it.
All right, exciting future. The future is bright and the future is digital. Thank you so much, Amor, Wei, for joining us, and we'll see you at the kickoff.
See you. See you tomorrow, everyone. Thank you.
See you guys.
All right.
See you at the Philippine FinTech Festival.
All right. Now, before we go, our blind item this morning, the pick of Restine. This is pure gold. Do let us know if you got that. Do tweet us at ANC Alerts. In the meantime, that is it for the show. I'm Michelle Long. Thank you so much for watching. Stay safe and stay with ANC.